I'm very pleased to be here. I really like it. I think I'm going to book the next 10 years. During my study as a historian, I know about the symposium and now I'm standing here, so that feels very good. Even then, that I'm a little bit nervous now, but that's okay. I'm going to tell you something about the Frikandel. And when I heard the first time of the topic of the symposium, I was thinking about big brains and stuff like that. And then on a later moment, I think I have to tell more about the Frikandel. And that's because when I was a young kid, I played soccer for a long time. And probably as everywhere in sport canteens, the food is very unhealthy. And in our sport canteen, a lot of people ate a frikandel or a bun with a frikandel on it after the soccer game. And I was wondering, why are so many people eating it when there are a lot of horror stories about it? The young kids are telling that it's made of udders, of brains, of cat meat and stuff like that. So, but in the Netherlands and part of Belgium, there are 600 million consumed frikandels each year. That makes that every inhabitant of the Netherlands have to eat it once a week. Well, I don't eat it often, almost never, but so probably some people eat more than one a week. Well, I started with a beautiful painting. It's one of my favorite. It's made by Van Dyck. He lived in Haarlem and also in Delft. First Delft after Haarlem. And this painting is from 1613. And I will explain what it has to do with the frikandel with snacks. But as you can see, there are always symbols in these paintings like this. And there's the sweetness of the apple, the sour of the grapes, the bitterness of the nuts, and the salt of the cheeses. And there are two cheeses on this, and they're painted really beautiful. But an old saying was that if you have too much dairy products, like cheeses or milk or stuff on that on paintings, then you bring the devil inside, because it's too much luxury. And this was the time of the Calvinistic sober time in the Netherlands started. And still, I think the food culture in the Netherlands can be seen as sober. And snacks are sober, easy, filling, cheap, stuff like that, real Dutch. So, this is the frikandel. I made the pictures all myself. On the left, well, it's the bun with the mayonnaise on it. On the right is my son. For the eating experiment, I called my wife and she was with my son at school, and I said I have to make a picture. It was 3 days ago or something. And I said, would you like him to eat a frikandel now? Yeah, and his little brother hates the frikandel, really disgusting. And so I made two of them. He really likes it. And as father and a former chef, okay. So what's more typical Dutch? I mean the simple things and the cheap things. It's easy going, eating on the way. The lunch boxes, every morning we make lunch boxes with brown bread in it. And the boterhamzakjes are the little bag for the bread, for takeaway. A real Dutch invention. But then the frikandel, as you can see, this is the automatiek. This is a food wall, very popular in the 30s everywhere, and now only in the Netherlands still available. You're on streets, you can put coins in it, and you can grab your snack, or hamburgers, or stuff like that. Well, as you can see, the frikandel, it's a sober, it's easy, and it's filling, it's quickly filling, so. Well, that's the, I think, the main reason why it's so popular in the Netherlands. this one is the famous, this. So it's always deep frozen. You can buy it in the supermarket deep frozen, and then deep fry it at home. Or you can buy it in a snack bar. A snack bar is a place where you can buy snacks, of course. And this is from the Bakkers, and I wrote about it. The Bakkers is the first one in the Netherlands, and in Belgium also, a big factory in Belgium now. And he started in the 50s with producing Frikandel, and in the late 70s it became a real factory. And he went to the US, there was the story, he went to the US and he was looking for a sausage that could be deep fried. And he tried it with the hot dogs, but with casings it explodes. So he produced a Frikandel without casings. So that's the story of the Frikandel. My main question was, why are the Frikandels so eaten so much in the Netherlands? While we know, we told each other that the horror stories about the Frikandel, but also nowadays it's still misty where Frikandels are made of. And it's called separator vlees, and separator vlees means that it's separated meat, so mechanically separated meat by a high pressure hose from the carcass, the meat, or scraped. So then I was thinking about it, and then okay, that is we don't know what we're eating, but still you can also say it's a little bit of it is sustainable because we're using all the meat of the animal, and not only killing it for the fillet or the chicken breast and stuff like that. So that are the deeper layers of the Frikandel. And there are no further scientific research about Frikandel. There's a lot about the croquette, but there's nothing about the Frikandel. There's only one or two scholars that say there used to be an historic recipe for the Frikandel. I found that also in a cookbook made for better cooking, I tried it myself to make it. But first, the ingredients. As you can see, that is separator vlees. The first one is from the chicken in this case. This is the Bakkers case, and there's also the lard in it from the pork, and a lot of E numbers. E621 also. And it tastes a little bit spicy. As I wrote in my article, you can find a little bit of taste of the Dutch Indies also inside it, if you are very romantic way. But as I explained earlier, is it waste or is it sustainable? I think it's nothing of both, I think, because they put the whole animal. It's not that the fillets are used for something else and they scrape it from the carcass and it's only for the Frikandel, so just throw the whole animal inside it in machines, and then they flat it and then they roll it. It's not very nice to see. So another aspect is that it has a very low culinary status, and it's also on low culture status. So these are actors from a movie, and that movie that goes, about guys and they're doing everything wrong, and they eat a lot of snacks. In this case, it was not a Frikandel, but you have this papau. I don't know if you know that papau. It's the bun. It's like a Chinese bun with meat inside, and you steam that, but they eat it deep fried. So there's a snack bar and they put it in the deep fry. And there's also another very popular TV series in the Netherlands, and they use the kipcorn. That's a meat stick made of chicken, a little bit similar to the Frikandel. So that explains those snacks are recommended by a low culture public. Because the croquettes, in the last 10 years, has a very high culinary status. A lot of books, a lot of articles are written about, but the Frikandel is different. And because the croquettes you can put different things inside it, and the Frikandel is the Frikandel. So maybe in those guys like this eat them more, and that's because why everybody's eating them once a week. But I think in the sport canteens and so it's also children eat it a lot. So now I, you see the book there. That's the 18th century recipes inside it for kitchen mates. And as you can see, I made the recipe from the 18th century. It is veal minced meat with a lot of lemon inside, lemon zest also, and a nutmeg. So it's also a little bit Dutch indie spicy. I think the only thing that's similar to each other is the color, because the one is with veal, the other is with chicken. So the lemon is really not inside of the frikandel, so I don't know what, only the name is the same. They call it the frikandelle. And there is also the frikadel, that's something different that came from Germany. It's more like a flat meatball. But they also say that's also an original frikandel, but I think it's just made in the 14th, made in the 50s with a little bit of copying. The one. Well, I have to grill it then. A little bit difficult because there's a lot of eggs inside, so it's flat. And I didn't have the casings because I needed that. But well, and this, as you can see, is the difference between them. And my kids liked that one and didn't like that one, and my friends, the other side. Yeah. And I will show you a little bit of a program that's on the television 2 weeks ago with the soccer, because Rafael van Vaart, famous soccer player in the Netherlands, he was in the program and he's getting a little bit fatter, and there's a discussion about what he's eating, and I will
Zou jij het leuk vinden om door hem geïnterviewd te worden?
Nou, niet elke dag, maar, maar het is wel eens een keer leuk om iets anders te doen. Weet je? Ik wil elke keer altijd met diezelfde vragen beantwoorden, dan wil je ook moe van als speler, dat is gewoon zo. Dus dat is wel eens een keer leuk, maar ja goed, we hebben nu een hele avontuur. Hij speelt geen rol, hij is echt niet gekant.
Ik zou met hem graag over voedsel willen hebben, hoor. Heb je dat toegegeven?
So they are talking about his food, and well, they have a nice discussion, but the discussion go on and on. I try to flame, but I don't know how it works. But he's getting angrier and angrier because, and that's you're eating too much snacks. First, it started with snacks, and you go every night to the snack bar, and at the end, now you're eating every day a frikandel. So that make it more worse than only the snacks. The frikandel is the most worst thing you can eat. I can show you a little bit.
Dat hij, als hij mag kiezen tussen een prachtige lekkere maaltijd, goed met de avocados en noten.
He's asking, you want to have a very healthy food or the snack?
Avond frikandelletjes halen voor zichzelf en kaas of vlees.
Frikandelletjes.
Dat hij iets is waar.
Kijk, dat is jammer dat hij dat zegt, want het is gewoon niet waar. Ten eerste, het is niet waar. We zitten lekker te discussiëren. Hij roept hier elke avond. Maar goed, hij zei, ben je wat aangekomen? Ik zei natuurlijk, 4 weken...
A little bit getting
better. En daar hebben we een discussie over. En hij zei, wat eet je liever? Dat wat hier op tafel staat, of een frikandel. Nou, er kwamen net geen eetjes van bij.
So there's a healthy food on there.
Kan je nou een professional? Jij zegt, het gaat erom dat de speler zich goed voelt. Of hij nou een grijze trainingbroek draagt, of elke dag zich helemaal vol stopt met frikandellen. Dat kan toch niet waar zijn dat een topsporter zulke slecht voedsel eet? Maar als die gast goed had gegeten, was hij nog beter geweest dan een
Now it's getting a little bit...
Nee, maar wel te vaak.
Als ik 1 keer per week een frikandel, is dat te veel?
Ja, once a week, frikandel. Nou hier.
Nee. Hoezo? Je levenskwaliteit is
dat dus slecht voor je lichaam.
Dus, ik bedoel, als ik dat nodig heb en ik voel me goed, waarom zou ik het niet nemen?
Omdat je nog beter wordt als je wel goed voedsel neemt.
Denk je dat?
Dat weet ik zeker.
Dat denk ik niet.
Nou, zullen we de uitdaging aangaan? Dat jij een maand gezond gaat eten, ik ga
het zelf ook. Ik ben dood.
Enough.
How did it end?
Well, at the end, he said something, let's talk about soccer and let him get his own food program, something like that. And this is Maxim Hartmann, and he, when I was a kid, he had a children program. It was really nasty. It was like with shit on the sidewalk, and then he fell in and things like that. Yeah, as a kid, I really liked that. And now he also wrote a book about women, and then he has got 40 typical women things and like women's did. So he's not very. You hate him or you love him. That's the thing. Yeah. I think I have to end. I hope to give you a little bit more insights of the Frikandel. This is the beautiful blue tile. It says, "Life is just like a Frikandel. You have to make him especially yourself." And a Frikandel special is a Frikandel with mayonnaise and ketchup and onions on top of it. So. It's a war, yeah. No, yeah. Special is with the satay sauce, eh?
Yeah.
Satay sauce, mayonnaise.
Yeah, everything, which is there.
Yeah, that's the war. You have war, peace, and special. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. I have a question a very important question, maybe. You said it's the most popular snack in the Netherlands, but is there any concurrence now from snacks from immigrants from all other parts of the world? Because I live in Rotterdam, and there are lots of other snacks now. Well, how is the snack culture?
Yeah.
But Frikandel is not anymore, I think, the number one.
Well, it's
the Americans don't eat it, the Turkish don't eat it. 50% of the population is from.
Yeah.
Other countries.
Yeah, and still it's a little bit declining, but it's my research sometimes is on websites like thuisbezorgd.nl, that is like when you can order your food online, but they say how many consumed, and they say 600 million each year, and the second one is the croquette with 300 million, so there's a lag between them of 300 million. So still, it is amazing how much they are consumed.
Yeah.
Really. Yeah.
Yes.
Is it similar to pepperoni? I mean, what exactly is the makeup of it? I mean, is it it's spicy?
Yeah, it's not that spicy. No, I mean more spicy because of the the nutmeg. But it's a little bit spicy, but not very spicy because children also can eat it. Yeah.
But is it like when you said it's like pepperoni, she means, I think, like built on, very dry.
Oh, no, that's not the case. It's the outside, it's not crispy or something, it's a little bit that, like that. No, maybe the feeling inside is a little bit that. It's a little bit soft. Inside, like a little bit. No. Well, I was thinking about that because this question. And that's also I think it's very. This morning I was thinking about it. This is very typical of Dutch food culture. I think is that if there is a reception or drinks anywhere, and you have like the cheap snacks on that, the cheap ones, then you have three, and that's the little Frikandel, the small one. You have like a bami schijf, that's noodles inside, also deep fried. And you have a spicy meatball, and they call it Indonesian meatball. So that are the three. And sometimes when I have a drink and I have to choose, then I take the Frikandel, but maybe twice a year or something.
Became popular in the 1950s or so with the deep frozen, and so I was wondering how much of the Frikandel is kind of an invented tradition within Dutch culture, and then also if it's associated with a brand that perpetuated it to this quotidian.
Yeah, well, the story I told about I went to America, it's like a brand story. Yeah? It's, they make it very beautiful, and I think it was they started in the 50s because snacks became more popular, and but it was still on a low scale, and from the end 70s and the 80s it became really a massive mass product. Yeah, and the factories and stuff
and
like that.
And is it tied to a certain brand that has pushed it into such popularity? Kind of like Oscar Mayer in the U.S. or Coca-Cola?
Yeah, I think, because Becker's is the biggest one. And they have, it is true that the starter of Becker's is Jan Becker's, and he invented the Frikandel. And there's a lot of stories that he tried to make a meatball, and it's ended like this. But yeah, and that's all a brand store. So
the most interesting, very interesting thing is that it doesn't fall apart when it goes into the freezer.
Yeah.
The secret must be hidden in the E numbers. Do you know if they use this enzyme which glues meat together?
Yeah.
That's the enzyme which makes blisters grow together.
Yeah, I'm not sure what they're using, but because there are also documentaries about how the Frikandel is made.
Fall apart because it's just a pot.
Yeah.
To have some glue into it. Which can lie all the.
Yeah, but they all flat also the meat very much, and they. Yeah. Sorry?
Is the Frikandel something that's never made at home? Is it always a commercial product?
It's
the only one made it at home.
It's you buy it from the freezer in the supermarket. It is not something, well, we're going to make Frikandels. No.
Right.
No.
So you cook it at home, but not really fried.
Really deep fried.
You don't know what's in it.
Any more questions?
Yeah. Am I wrong in supposing that the Frikandel is made with something that's called pink slime and that has been a scandal recently in the US? It does sound familiar. If there's anybody from the States, the pink slime is something that's made with separator meat, isn't it? And this sounds very much
it's
like
mechanically recovered
technology, doesn't it?
It is slightly different.
It is different.
This is MRM.
Oh, okay. Right.
I mean, there's a debate here, I think.
Can I say?
Yes,
I think there's a really important debate here that I was trying to get at yesterday, to say there's offal and there's offal.
Mm-hmm.
This is offal for the masses, ultra processed, instant, standardized, cheap.
Yeah.
I presume it's very, very cheap. I mean, it's a way of using nice meat byproducts, isn't it? That's the clever thing, but it's held together with an extraordinary mixture of ingredients.
Mm-hmm.
This is the brilliance. This is typical Dutch agri technology, actually. It's really interesting.
Yeah.
But I'm very pleased it stays in the Netherlands.
Yesterday I heard your story. I think you can come to the Netherlands with
Last question now.
Well, it's not that a caseinato. The brilliance is that this is.
It doesn't have caseinato, but I meant in terms of quality and production.
It's the same crap.
Yeah. What I wanted to say was it's interesting, they were attacking his sort of morality. I don't know, I don't speak Dutch, but it sounded like they were purposely provoking him, right? Because it's food for the masses, and he should be above that. He should be a model.
He started to.
He's getting fat.
And at the same time, there's this moral argument for using all the animal products.
There's a very, very interesting, if you don't know, there's an amazing, interesting project going on in Norway at the moment called Eat Sweet Move, using footballers. Who, when they are fit, they're fantastically fit, to actually try and be role models for children. And to get them to sleep, the kids would sleep rather than eat all the time.
Run 2 hours a day.
Eat, move, sleep. It's a really interesting project. It's now a national project. And it's trying to get kids to
get people like him, when he was a really big footballer, to not role model Frikandel, but to role model a real eating culture. It's really interesting. So I thought that argument on the telly was really interesting.
Yeah.
So, yes, we must stop. Thank you very much, Lenno.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Thank you.
Okay, our second speaker is Nina Bauer. And she's new as well, so a warm welcome to Nina. And she's from Denmark. And she's a food historian, and she studied museology as well at the University of Copenhagen. Yeah. She specialized in food and nutrition during the Second World War, and she knows everything about oysters as well. Well, and she's also a contributor to the and of course she has written about Danish cheese men. But now she's going to tell you about another, you could say, national food item, leverpostej. And well, in the Netherlands there's something else called leverpostej, in Germany there's leverpostej, but this is a very different kind of liver parts, we should say that in English. Well, Nina, you're going to tell the names and I'll say
Do you want to take off a second?
Cool.
Yeah, that's fine. Pop back on for me.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Not in the Netherlands, not in Denmark. Okay.
Well,
okay, sure.
Since I don't have a lot of time and I can really talk for a very long time if you let me, I'll try to be sort of brief and just try to give you an idea of how important leverpostej is in Denmark. And I will start doing that by giving you a little quote from a journalist who was describing the biggest company that produces leverpostej in Denmark at their they had an jubileum, and he wanted to celebrate the leverpostej because of that, and he said, "If something has been the fuel and molecular building blocks for dairymen, shot putters, nuclear physicists, kayakers, windmill producers, filmmakers, soccer players, and all other Danes who have raised the red and white flag high in the world, it is the minced mix of pig's liver, speck, onions, anchovies, and spices. It is the leverpostej, and it is this minced mix that is baked in aluminum trays and then eaten all over the country." In 2007, there was a survey where they found out that it is 92% of all Danes who eat leverpostej. And of them, 26% said they ate it daily. So it is really a Danish phenomenon. No. And the way most people encounter leverpostej in Denmark the first time is at school. It is the number one thing you get in your lunchbox when you go to school. And it has been so for a very long time, which I will show with a little commercial from the 1954. It's all in Danish, but I think you don't need to understand what's being said. But it shows a typical school scene, and at the same time, it's a commercial for a leverpostej.
Skal jeg skrive hans vigtigste bygningsværker op på tavlen? Ja.
Du, Per, jeg vil have dig til at blive sulten af. Værsgo. Åh, du stykker med leverpostej. Er det den gode, du plejer at have med? Nemlig.
Og jeg spiser midt i timen.
Det var kun sulej, at du spiste, herr lærer.
Jamen, hvor kan det falde dig ind?
Jeg kan så godt lide leverpostej.
Så kan du blive siddende en time efter skoletid. Slemme dreng.
Der er vendt på mig.
Åh, det manglede da bare.
Det var pænt, da jeg tager hele skylden på det i timen. Tog du forresten de sidste stykker leverpostej med dig? Hvor kan det egentlig være, at den leverpostej, du har med, altid smager så mægtig godt?
Very interesting thing about this and leverpostej is it's an industrialized meat or dish. It has never been a homemade dish that has been picked up by the food industry. It started out as an industrialized product because in Denmark we produce a lot of pigs and we slaughter a lot of pigs. And in the end of the 18th century, we started exporting a lot of bacon to England, bacon and butter. And all this bacon meant that the number of pigs being slaughtered skyrocketed. Around 1900, you would slaughter about 1 million pigs a year in Denmark. That meant for a lot of liver. And this liver was made into leverpostej, because at the same time, this leverpostej and this idea of mincing liver started out as an upper class thing because you had to mince it by hand. But with meat grinders and other things, you were able to make it industrial scale. And this meant you suddenly have this product who is it's quite cheap to make. You mince these things and you bake them in the trays and then it's finished. And it became very easy, and it's very nutritious if you look at it with early 21st century eyes. You have a lot of minerals, you get iron from it, you get a lot of good things. And so when you bought your leverpostej, you would buy it at a viktualieforretning, which is kind of like a Danish version of a charcuterie. Except you will get your leverpostej and sometimes your pickled herring as well and other things, so not just meat. And before you had a refrigerator at home, you would have to buy this in slices because leverpostej doesn't keep very well. It can keep for a couple of days if you're lucky. So every day, almost every day, the housewives would have to venture down to the store and buy slices, which will then be put on rye bread and packed into lunch boxes for every member of the family. The dad would usually get more, and if they could afford other kinds of lunch meat, he would get that, and the children would get the leverpostej only, like we saw in the commercial, with 8 pieces of it. And if they really didn't even have money for leverpostej, they would get rye bread with either lard or just sugar on it instead. This, that leverpostej, is actually usually factory made and not homemade. I think you have to go up to about during the 1950s and especially in the 1960s before it is something that housewives make regularly at home, and then usually around holidays, because you eat this at Christmas in Denmark too. That gave birth to jokes. This is from a newspaper. I haven't been able to date it, but it's from around the 1970s. And the sign says it's Granny's homemade leverpostej. And as you can see, the leverpostej is in the shape of a factory. That's because there is a common joke in Denmark about the leverpostej you buy in the shop. The joke is that we have a French pâté and we have the homemade leverpostej. Then what is the difference, the customer asks. And the answer is the French pâté we make ourselves. But we still like in Denmark to make it ourselves, or at least pretend we make it ourselves. So in the supermarket, you can actually buy frozen minced liver, All you have to do is pop it in the oven. So you can make it yourself at home. Because at holidays, when you eat leverpostej, you eat it warm. Normally, for lunch, you will cut a slice and spread it on bread and eat it cold. But at holidays, you will heat it up in the oven, and then you will decorate it with mushrooms and bacon, usually. So it's more festive. As you can see, this is actually from a Danish food blog. This is a homemade leverpostej. The funny thing about this is, if you take away the bacon, it will look exactly like the factory made because you use the same aluminum tins to make it. You actually buy these and you make it yourself, but it looks just like the store-bought. And as I said, it's an important part of Danish lunches, especially because we take our lunch boxes with us everywhere. And the idea of eating open sandwiches you made yourself and you eat it at lunch break. Even though this is from, as you can see, 2014, and it's about the school lunch, and even though there are all kind of exotic and interesting things coming into the kids' lunch boxes, leverpostej here with pickled beetroot is still number one, and everyone eats it. And this way of eating in the school, it translates over to the workplace. As you can see, I have another commercial I would like to show you. It's, I think it's only about a year old or something like that, and it's from Struens, which is the biggest factory in Denmark producing leverpostej. And also in the local town where the factory is situated, it has taken the role of a cultural patron. So everything in this town where the factory is, every cultural festival or something, is supported by leverpostej. It says, take it easy, put Struens on it, and decorate it yourself. It doesn't have to be any greener than that. This is very important for... yeah. Because as you can see here on the leverpostej, this is very, very decorated. It looks kind of bland. It doesn't have an appealing color or anything. Actually, it looks so bland that it has given name to a color in Denmark. Things can be leverpostej colored. Hair, you can have the color of leverpostej. You can say if the weather is really, really boring and it's not bad weather, but it's not good weather either, it's leverpostej. You can find in newspapers a number of headlines that mention leverpostej that has nothing to do with food. I think one of my favorites was an article about economy, in the economy section of the daily newspaper, that said the world economy is still gray weather and leverpostej. And every Dane will know what that means. It's not a good thing. So even though all Danes will love it, and when I told people I was researching leverpostej, they came and they told me their memories or their favorite brand or how they thought it should be decorated and eaten. Even though they love it, they will still say it's some of the most boring things you can talk about. It is so typical in Denmark. So in a campaign to recycle more, they try to compare what are the typical Danish things. So what this says is, did you know that 333 trays of leverpostej contains enough aluminium to make a new bicycle? There you have what they think is quintessential Danish, leverpostej and bicycles. Everything will be all right then. Because I said in the beginning that around 1900 there were about 1 million pigs being slaughtered. Today the number is about 30 million, so we have a lot of leverpostej to eat. Thank you.
Thank you. Nina, in your article you wrote about butchers, halal butchers, who make the leverpostej with halal meat.
Yeah.
So it means that it's really everybody eats leverpostej in their own way.
And even the, some of the halal butchers, even though they, you can see at the sign, they don't really know what leverpostej is. They have an idea. But they will usually spell it differently sometimes. So you can see a sign where it would be spelled leverpostejen, which is steg. And the Danish word steg is the same as roast.
Okay.
So they know what they're making, but even though the spelling doesn't really work and they're not really sure, they make it. They make it with chicken livers or calf livers instead. But because they know it's, you're in Denmark, you have to eat leverpostej, some form of leverpostej, and you have to know what it is.
That's integration.
Absolutely.
Okay, questions.
What's in it besides the minced liver?
Well, there's minced liver, then there's speck, onions, and anchovies, and some spices, which can be, it's a little different what you have. You have, I don't know really the name in English. It's the spices are not very dominating in it, and you have this. You make it to a paste, a very runny paste, and then, usually with a sort of you put flour and you know, and something in it. You have this runny mixture that you then pour into a tray and then bake. So that it will have a crust, okay. It will have a brown crust, and then they will have the soft, the spreadable bits underneath. It actually so that leverpostej during the Second World War, they had a problem because people started cheating. The factory started cheating, so it was hard to get liver. Liver got more expensive, so they used other kinds of offal, like udders and lungs and different things. Even leftover from the fishing industries. So because of that, the government had to make a standardization of leverpostej, and that started that you can only call it leverpostej if there's at least 20% liver in it, because it got really bad. And the problem during the war was that they weren't trying to like raise the bar; they were trying to stop the worst. Cases of them. Then after the war, they stopped the standardization, the rules, but most of the factories still for a long time kept to the at least 20%. But now the liver content has gone up again because there's been more development. Even some of the cooks at Noma were invited to the factory, to Streams, to talk with them and try to develop new ways of using leverpostej and view leverpostej. You can have. You can have eggs in it. The most usually is to make sort of a roux, with flour and some kind of. Yeah. Yeah. can.
Whereas if you're talking about 20% as minimum RE, 40%, what I ask is what's in the rest of the percentage? Like, is it flour based? Is it?
There is usually not completely flour based. There's flour. There's some liquids. There can be milk or stock in it as well. There are some different things. But it's mainly pig's liver still. And the funny thing is here that people who claim they don't like offal will still eat leverpostej, because for some reason, it is, for them, it's so far removed from the raw liver that they can see it as something completely different.
Is there such a thing as any kind of, you know, gourmet version, any spectrum, a sort of high end, or is it very much a sort of basic staple?
It is very much a basic staple, but you can go to Danish lunch restaurants and they will make it themselves. That's also a very funny thing. We will eat leverpostej at lunch. We'll eat it at the Christmas lunches, at holidays, and we will go out. And when we order our open sandwiches on restaurants, a piece of leverpostej is also available, and people actually buy it. So you can base your whole dinner plan on leverpostej if it should be so.
What are other kinds of pâté called in Danish? So you probably have other kinds of pâté as well. What is the Danish word for those?
Well, we don't have, actually, not Danish types, so they would just be called pâté.
So
that
you just use the French word, basically.
We just use the French word, yeah.
So there's no Danish word for other kinds of pâté-like things?
No, not really.
Okay. So even coolies eat leverpostej?
What?
Coolies, foodies, sorry.
Yeah, they will eat it too.
Everybody.
Yeah, as I showed, there are a lot of food blogs that... There are a lot of food blogs that will champion their own recipe of leverpostej and something, but yeah, everybody eats it.
Yeah. Last question.
In the 60s, when Denmark were invaded by French gnomes for cuisine, they started to slice liver paste and put it on a plate and cook it with a cornichon side, and then they call it pâté.
Yeah.
So it's getting transformed.
And
okay.
But in the beginning, in the end of the 18th century, where making leverpostej was something that the charcuterie exclusively did, it was considered very high status. And at that time, you would eat it more like a French pâté. So you would cut a very small slice or a small bit and then eat it with bread. And you have memoirs of people in Copenhagen, a composer who write about there was a guest in his home who was a glutton. So he took a big slice of the leverpostej and everybody hated inviting him after that. It was the biggest dining faux pas you could do in that family that was not respecting that it was a fine dining experience.
Hello. Icelanders have a very curious relationship with what we consider as our traditional food, which happens to be more or less offal based. It can't be said really that we are proud of it, and many of us don't even like it, especially younger people. Some of it disgusts some of us, but we still like to talk about it, describe it to tourists, and often in quite gruesome terms. We like to describe how it's prepared and cooked and eaten, and we embellish the stories with some facts, some of them very dubious. And we talk about, for instance, sheep's heads, ram's testicles, black pudding, things like that, mostly offal, mostly preserved in fermented way. And sometimes we serve it to unsuspecting tourists. And Icelanders often seem to think that no one else eats anything like those bits. And most people sincerely believe that this is the food we have eaten ever since the settlement 1100 years ago, virtually unchanged. and they look at the thorri trade. Thorrablót is our midwinter feast, which I talk about in a paper here a couple of years ago and gave some tasting samples. And this is more or less what people think is traditional Icelandic food. And yes, some of it is. But there are also many, many dishes that have disappeared that Icelanders don't know about and which would frankly disgust them if they knew about them. And some Icelanders who read my paper, they said, did we really eat this? Is this true? How did you discover it? And the reason I'm so interested in those dishes is because I grew up in a farm in Northern Iceland in the 1960s. And very much was still done there in the old way. Well, let me first talk about the conditions in Iceland. Iceland is, well, it used to be for hundreds of years, one of the poorest, if not the poorest country in Europe. There were always somewhere north of life. There was, we couldn't grow any grain, we couldn't grow any vegetables, no fruit, except a few, there were few wild types of berries. And we had to adapt to very harsh conditions, and we had to import almost, well, salt and things like that. There was lack of firewood, lack of almost everything. So we didn't, bread is not traditional in Iceland except very thin flat bread. And another problem was preservation, because lambs and other animals were usually slaughtered only during a few weeks in the autumn and then had to be preserved throughout the year. Fish, which we had a lot of, but only in the late winter and early spring, that was the main fishing season, and we had to preserve that as well. And dairy, which we had most of during the summer, everything had to be preserved. So offal is of course a problem because, as someone said this morning, you can't preserve it. But we had to discover methods to do that. And what we did was, most offal in Iceland was preserved in fermented way. It was kept in huge barrels and could keep for, well, throughout the year. And well, as I said, I grew up on a farm in Northern Iceland in the 1960s, and many of the old food traditions still survived on the family farm. My family has lived there for 283 years. On this farm. So, and it was very primitive when I was a child. We didn't have electricity or anything, and you couldn't go to the shops when you lacked something because that was 40 kilometers away and the roads were very bad. So my mother made almost everything at home, and she did it, most of it, using the old methods, and she used more or less everything she could find. Nothing was ever thrown away. My mother made it all into food, every scrap of the animal, if not for the people, then at least for the dogs. There were a couple of huge barrels in the larder filled with food preserved in fermented way, almost all of it made from offal. But in another room where the dogs slept, there was another barrel which contained things that were preserved for the dogs. Those were things that had formerly been used as human food. Things like lungs and others and but the old man on the farm, my grandfather and his brothers, they often craved things they had eaten when they were children. They went into the dog's barrel and of course I tasted it with them. So, but these things were simply boiled and then put into the whey. But many offal dishes that had been used earlier probably disappeared because they were bothersome and time-consuming to make, or maybe some of them because people were not as desperately poor as they had been and could afford not to eat such things as ruslakeppur or trash bag, which was a method to use up all the odds and ends from the carcass. Cut-offs from the from tripe, liver and lungs, and uterus, glands, just about everything. This was mixed with chopped fat and sewn into a piece of lamb stomach and then boiled and put into the whey barrel. It had been used as human food for up until the late 19th century, I think. I have no evidence that it was ever eaten by people after that, but it was still made for the dogs. And another dish that had disappeared by the time I remember was croaker steak or hook steak, which was the uterus of a cow or ewe, which was cut up and scraped, boiled whole, or preserved in whey, or maybe, added to a trash bag or something like that. This is a very old term because I found mentions of croaker steak, hook steak, in sources from the 14th century. And I know it was the last time I know it, but for sure it was served was at a midwinter feast in my home region in 1897. But many of those vanished offal dishes were not simply food for the poor and starving. They were considered delicacies and held in high regard. For instance, gotlur is, what's it called? Pericardium, a lump sack around the heart. It was inverted, so the fat was on the inside, and then it was stuffed with all kinds of goodies like pieces of the heart itself, maybe some meat, fatty meat, and then it was boiled and served to children as a treat or a prize. I never got any, but maybe I didn't deserve any. And there's an old Icelandic lullaby which every child in Iceland knows by heart, which talks about the gotlur, and they sing it and they have no idea what it was, and it would probably amaze them if they knew. Another thing that was highly valued was the blood of lamb and other animals. It was always held in high regard, and I remember reading a story about a man who was hunting wild sheep in the mountains in southeastern Iceland, and he was unable to drive the animals he caught back home, so he had to slaughter them in the mountains, but he had to preserve the blood. When he had nothing else, he would take off his hat. I don't know what kind of hat he had, but he would let the blood run into his hat, and then he took out the stomach of the dead sheep and cleaned it and put the blood in that and carried it home. So blood was very valuable. And one of my favorite dishes when I was, my favorite dessert when I was a child was blood pudding, This is a kind of, you know, it's like chocolate pudding, but it was always made of veal blood, very young veal, and it was it had raisins and was served with milk and cinnamon sugar, and I haven't tasted this dish actually for almost 50 years, mostly because, three-day-old cows can be hard to get by, come by, you know, even in Iceland. And when I was preparing my paper, I discovered that I had some lamb's blood in my freezer, as you do, and I did an experiment. Of course, I watched my mother make this many times, but I knew what she did, but the proportions, I think I got them a bit wrong. It was not as thick as that usually, and the taste was not quite the same. Strange how you remember childhood taste sometimes, because I can vividly recall the taste of this dish that I haven't tasted for 50 years, and there was something in the lamb version, but it wasn't there. And one writer has described this dish as living honey. And there are no land game animals in Iceland, but we had seals and whales. And they were, of course, used as food, and the offal was used too. One of dishes that is still popular in some families is seal flippers, which are singed and then boiled and eaten at the winter feasts. But I haven't found much on the use of whale offal, except the blubber, which is whale-preserved. Whale blubber is still very popular in Iceland. It's served at midwinter feasts and sometimes to tourists. You can buy it in most shops. But I'm told that in the old days, the very best blubbers was considered to be the bit surrounding the blowhole. It was then hung to dry and ferment for a few months before it was eaten. That is not done now. It's just placed into a barrel away. But and the whale's tongue was also eaten, and we didn't hunt the whales. We just ate the beach whales, and they sometimes saved many lives in times of famine, of hunger, and kvalreki or the beaching of a whale is still a term in Icelandic for something that is very fortunate and unexpected. And I couldn't find any photographs or drawings of the cutting off of a whale in Iceland, but I found this one, and the tail and flippers, the tail of a fin whale was eaten, but it needed to be boiled for a whole day, according to my sources. And well cleaned, boiled, and whey-preserved whale intestines were edible, according to an 18th century writer, who also says that whale penises they gave strength and power to those who ate them, but he doesn't give a recipe. Then to the fish, because of course we used up the whole fish as well. And dried fish was one of the mainstays of the Icelandic cuisine, and sometimes served three times a day. And the heads, they were much used. And Icelanders, of course, other people do eat fish heads, but Icelanders made a real art of it. In his work, Íslenski sjávarhættir, food historian Lúðvík Kristjánsson lists no less than 363 names for various parts of a cod's head, including 21 names for different parts of the skin, 36 for membranes, 109 for muscles, and 156 for bones and cartilage. And the book devotes 14 pages to descriptions of the proper techniques of tearing up a dried cod's head, naming every single bone, every part of the gills, every small muscle, along with a description of how they were eaten or utilized. And the dried skin of a codfish head was always used. People said if someone threw it away, he was despising the gifts of God, because you had to go just as far to cut the skin as the fish itself, so you shouldn't waste it. And the bones were used too. There was a dish called bone fat, which was made from the bones of a small halibut that had been filleted. They were then buried in gravel at the beach for 2 or 3 days and then hung up to dry until they had taken on a red hue. This was then boiled and eaten and was considered a treat. And a poem from the 17th or 18th century described it as very good for the stomach. And fish bones, fins and tails, along with some fish skins, were preserved in barrels of fermented whey for a good while. They then were boiled or steamed for several hours until they began to soften somewhat, but not quite, because the name of this dish is brunningur or crunch, and it was not exactly popular. It was eaten by the poor in times of hunger. But the stomach of several types of fish, called kutmai, was cleaned and either dried and then boiled and preserved in whey or stuffed with fish livers, or a mixture of liver and rye flour. Kutmai is actually not quite forgotten, because some male clubs in Iceland they serve it at special functions and very popular with certain people. Mostly older men. Swim bladders were boiled until soft and preserved in fermented whey or in some skyr. They are a rich source of isinglass, and if a bladder was parboiled briefly, then put into a bowl of skyr. Skyr, an Icelandic yogurt product you might have heard about. The skyr coagulated and could be cut into slices, and this was sundmagaskyr. It was considered a real treat. Now, people use isinglass in jellies and desserts before gelatin became popular, at least. But I'm not sure if swim bladders were ever used as a dessert by themselves anywhere else but in Iceland. But there are Icelandic recipes for whey-preserved swim bladders, cut up small, caramelized in sugar, and served with whipped cream. I haven't tasted them. Well, it was not, of course, we ate fish raw and many, you know, we made them into cakes and bread and waffles and or boiled them and preserved in whey, and that's still done to some extent, but swill or cod's testicles with semen, or milt, I think, I'm not sure of the correct English term. That was either buried in earth and fermented, or boiled and then preserved in fermented whey, as so many other Icelandic dishes. It could also be smoked or hung in an airy place and half dried before cooking. Or it could be made into sviljaostur, fish, semen, cheese, does that? When you took fresh swill and boiled them and churned them in a milk churn, stirred it into fresh milk and added some fermented whey, and this was drained in a cheesecloth to make it into a kind of cheese. Well, that's some of the dishes that I have written about in my paper. I cannot cover them all, but there are many of them and many. And in summary, it can be said that Iceland became quite good at using every scrap of the meager resources they had. Other nations did that too, but some of the methods and recipes used in Iceland may have been rather unique. And I'm going to end by, I haven't talked about a lamb's head because that's still, that's not disappeared. We still eat that quite a lot. But it's always cooked and eaten whole. The cheeks are not sold separately, nor the ears or the tongue or the eyes. I don't know if when Paul Rosen showed the photo of the eyes that he got served at a restaurant, I wonder if I was the only one in the who thought, yum. because when I was a child, you know, and we had boiled sheep's head, I always got, my uncles always cut out the eye and put it on my plate because they knew how much I liked them. And well, but the tongues of other animals were treated separately. And my favorite sandwich filling when I was a child was smoked foal's tongue. I don't even know how to pronounce it. Foal's tongue. And that's another vanished treat. Until a few years ago, I hadn't had it since I was a child. It's never been sold in any shops, and very few Icelanders know about it, have heard about it. I discovered that one of my cousins still makes it, and I'm going to give some to taste if you like. But I know this is a double disgust factor because it's tongue, which not everyone likes, and it's horse. So,
horse.
Young horse.
Smoked.
Horse.
Smoked.
Yeah, that's.
In the meantime, are there any questions? Yes, you
okay?
Oh, thank you.
Yeah. First,
piece of.
Oh yes, I probably. Well, I can take another one.
Okay.
Gorgeous. I just wondered about the way the cuisines of really poor countries have come together, even so far apart as Iceland and Italy, because the blood pudding, the sweet blood pudding with raisins. It's a fixture of South Italy, So it's in South Italy. But of course, in your situation, it was different because you had to buy the raisins, and that would be probably
very
expensive.
Yeah, but the raisins are not necessarily traditional. The blood pudding my mother made when I was a child, they didn't have any raisins.
I didn't have raisins.
No,
okay,
no.
Yeah.
I think that's something that maybe have been added in the 20th century even, but these dishes like blood pudding and that's not because of poverty. Everybody eats it. Yeah,
the sweet blood pudding, not because.
The sweet blood pudding. Sorry.
The North pudding is salty blood pudding, and then when you go down, it's getting sweeter and sweeter and sweeter.
Uh-huh. that's the same. It's a raisins there. Yeah.
Also, I wondered about the cheeks, the cold cheeks. Were they considered a separate delicacy?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes.
And the tongue as well, cold tongue and cold cheeks,
Mm-hmm. And still is, but which is why I didn't talk about it now, because you could get that at almost every Reykjavik restaurant,
Because that's fantastic.
Nanna, can you give us tasting notes for the cod's eye, why you liked them?
No, it's all sheep's eyes, lamb's eyes,
Sheep's
eyes? Yes.
Tasting
notes.
Tell us.
I think in the beginning was, actually I did like the tongue better, but I had a younger sister who was, Yeah, she always won, and she got the tongue, and I had to settle for the eyes, and then I... So that was a bit the beginning, but then I discovered that I liked them even more because mm-hmm. they were tastier, they were fatty, and all the things I liked when I was a child.
Into solid?
No, it's in liquid form. You have to stir it when it's very fresh. You know, when the throat of an animal was cut, you had to immediately begin to stir it, then it wouldn't coagulate. And when I was 15, I worked in a slaughterhouse, and there was an old lady there whose only job was stirring the blood.
Market and buy blood, then you buy it in a scoop or in a
pouch? No, you would just buy it in 1 liter bottles. Only at certain times of year, only during the autumn. Sorry. Yeah.
Where do the horses come from? Are they bred fish? Are they old horses? Are they wild horses?
Well, they are semi-wild, you know, some of them, because Icelandic horses they run free in the mountains in summer, and then during the winter they are either kept inside or they are at home on the farm, but they are not necessarily tame.
Not tame.
Well. Some of them are. Yeah.
Is it a certain age? Are they killed off a certain age?
Some when about 6 months old. Yeah. Those foals, they were probably about 6 months old. Uh-huh. And some are well rather old. We sell many of them to Japan, I think. There's a market there for very fatty meat of old horses.
Really?
Yeah. And then we cook a lot of it at home. So. Yeah.
I'm interested in the dogs.
Yes.
Why did the food that your grandfather and great uncles ate? Mm-hmm. Stopped being eaten by the family and became the dog food. What was that transition?
Well,
what were the dogs eating before that?
More or less the same, I think. But it was probably because the family was better off. People didn't have to eat everything, and things like lungs and to be made into dishes for people, you usually had to do something with them, you know. But for the dogs, you just boiled it and put it into a barrel. But they still liked the taste of it, you know.
What do dogs eat now? I will guarantee I know. They're getting the better food. That's what
yeah.
It's about 4 to 8% of all meat production now is fed to dogs.
Mm.
Yeah. They don't eat the offal anymore. You go and find out. I tell you, I nearly said it in my speech yesterday. It's really interesting. Dogs are the indicators. Let dogs eat the offal.
Yeah.
Why are dogs eating the best food? It's really interesting.
What about cats? Is there a difference between cat food
and... Yeah, this is the huge growth of the pet market. It's changing the meat industry.
Yeah.
I wanted to ask about fish. I saw a documentary film in the spring about the Faroe Islands.
Uh-huh.
I know it's not the same as Iceland, and the country is somewhat different. And there they have a tradition of eating whale. There's a whale hunt, the smaller whales, they just near the shore, they push them into shore, basically beach them and kill them, so they have a whale hunt that way. They're small whales. Pilot whales, perhaps, is the word?
Yep.
Anyway, there's an issue there in the Faroes with people who want to eat this traditional food, even though they can afford to eat more imported food. There's a taste for the traditional food,
There's an issue because of mercury poison. And so there's been a tracking of mercury content in populations starting about 40 years ago. So there's actually a history, there's a documentation of the mercury content in children, in breast milk, in women. And there's been this attempt to discourage people from eating as much whale meat, not because of any save the whales thing, nothing like that, but because of this issue. So you said there isn't a whale hunt in Iceland. You have all kinds of other food from the sea, but I wondered if there was a mercury, sorry for the long question, I wonder if there is a mercury toxicity for you. Or is the sea maybe so deep that the, I mean, I don't know, it's in the Faroes, it's something to do with the sea bottom being close enough that at the top of the pyramid, those fish near the Faroes are actually a represent a concentration of mercury.
It's not been considered a problem, but some people are starting to talk about it, that it might be an issue, but we don't eat as much whale as the Faroe Islanders do, and not so much...
You eat more diversity.
Yeah.
This bee here, when you do, I'm out of date on this, on the mercury, it's always been associated with industrial pollution, not with natural fishing.
It was industrial, but the industrial pyramid, that's why I framed the question that way. But we don't eat so much whale. It's very fatty,
I'm wondering what you think the rest of the world can learn and to preserve your cuisine, you know, because it seems like we should be going back to some of them.
I think some studies have shown that whey preserved food is actually very healthy. Many younger Icelanders especially think of it as spoiled food, as something that's almost rotten, but the fact is that it gets added nutrients from the whey, so while the raw material isn't always quite healthy, lots of fat and things like that, but it does get some added goodness from
the fermented way.
Yeah.
Okay, well, thank you very much. Thank you very much.